Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Talking TSR. I'm your host, Chris, and to my virtual left, we have Rick, as usual. So how are you doing there, Rick?
I'm doing good. How's life treating you, my friend?
Very well, very well. So it's August. I can't believe it's August 1st. So, you know, things just cruising along. Every time we turn around, we're doing another show, which is amazing. A little bittersweet. This would have been Gen Con weekend. So I would have been on an airplane right now coming back, and I would have been exhausted. So and full of lots of memories and seeing everybody. But, you know, so that's a little bit sad. But Gen Con is coming in a couple of weeks. So people just need to sit tight for that. And, you know, hopefully this weekend next year, we'll all be together. Maybe we'll be doing this episode from a hotel room, which would be awesome. That would be. I'd sign up for that for some sketchy hotel internet. That'd be cool. So,
yeah, not quite the same this summer yet, but we're getting there. You know.
So, how are you doing? What's up with you in your world?
Yeah, I'm doing good. I actually met with my group in person, so nice. I was ecstatic to do that. Very last minute meeting. You know, we had to wrangle some things around, but to actually see people at the table was great. I'm going to throw out a couple quick shout outs. Thank yous. One of my players gave me the Dungeon Master's little black book
from
Kickstarter, which is a little book full of tables and things like that with supplemental material. I love that. My awesome co-host who I'm going to thank on the air gave me the D&D animated series, which we will have to circle back on in a future episode.
There will be one coming.
Yeah, so lots of cool presents this week. Just good week, yeah. Good D&D vibes this week. So
excellent. Yeah, no, we've been board gaming again. It's been nice just to do some in-person stuff and, you know, playing a couple of new games that we've had, you know, a year and a half. The new game's still coming out and everything, and haven't had a chance to play them with more than two or three people in outside of the family. So it's been good. It's been good. So very, very excited. So we've got an exciting one, exciting discussion for you guys tonight. So we're following up on the heels of L1, The Secret of Bone Hill, with L2, The Assassin's Knot. Mm-hmm. And this is an intriguing module. And mm-hmm. we're gonna really dive into this sucker and talk about it a lot. So sit back, relax. This is kind of like, you know, this show I think is starting to turn into that Saturday night at Gen Con in an Indianapolis hotel bar, but whichever hotel you want, whichever, you know, Hyatt doesn't really have a bar, but Omni, I think, had a really nice bar.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, just two old guys just talking about books that are 40 years old again, kind of like a 40-year-old book club kind of thing. And thanks for coming along for the journey with us. And if you guys have any questions in the chat, you guys want to see any shows coming up, let us know. But we're going to talk about The Assassin's Knot. We're going to talk about murder mysteries in D&D. So why don't you get us kicked off on that, Rick?
Yeah, I mean, that's the whole idea of the murder mystery in D&D is a really interesting topic, because it's not to every DM's taste. It's not something that's easy to run necessarily. It could be a complicated thing. I personally think they're wonderful for a change of pace. I'll admit I myself don't do them that often, you know, but when I've done them, they're usually pretty memorable. But you know, you got to follow the rules, right? So what would be, off the top of your head, what would be one tip you would throw out there, say, for dungeon masters about running a murder mystery
I think what murder mysteries, you know, it's not so much the plot, it's not so much, you know, how was it done. I think that is part of it. I think it's really about two things, and I know you're gonna definitely jump on one, so I'll start kind of with the other one. The first one is really detailed NPCs. You mm-hmm. really need NPCs that are going to stand out, and be that via a physical description or a different voice or something. Mm-hmm. That's what you really need, because you're probably going to have a lot of NPCs, and the characters need to not be getting confused over them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they don't have name tags like at a convention. I mean, everybody laughs about the badges at Gen Con and all that, but, you know, those of us in the industry, we actually kind of love those, because we can't remember everybody's name. So it's like, you know, you get yourself into a bad spot when somebody's badge is flipped over and you're trying to have a conversation with them. You're like, I know this person, but, you know, so I think that's the first thing. And I think the second thing is the clues. And I think this is probably the biggest stumbling block in either not enough clues, or the clues aren't obvious enough, or, you know, they're not, you know, I think, you know, when you're designing a murder mystery, you got to have more clues than you think you need.
Oh, yeah.
You cannot have everything grind to a halt because they missed this, you know, a search check or a perception check, or they're just not putting two and two together. I mean, mm-hmm. So that's probably the two biggest things. What do you think?
Yeah. Well, I mean, first off, I wholeheartedly agree with both points you mentioned, because obviously a mystery is going to be a lot more NPC centric. You know, you're not usually casually talking the monsters you fight, but in the case of this, you know, you're trying to get information, you're trying to sift through the people. So, you know, through your suspects, or, you know, get information from your witnesses, all that kind of stuff. So like you said, differentiating the different NPCs, absolutely agree, super important. I echo the clue statement as well. My kind of rule of thumb is to provide twice as many clues as I think. Literally assume that your players will find one out of three clues. And if you go by like that kind of standard, I think you're on a good road. And I also like to think of it as a maze, that if the players have to find their way through the figurative maze to get to the, you know, the true culprit, there should be more than one way through that maze. Don't set them up where the lack of one clue or the lack of piecing together one piece of information will dead end them, because that is going to bring your adventure, I would say, to a crashing halt, or potentially. So it's much better to give them a few different avenues to figure out things. The one item I would throw on top of that, which I personally love to use in my own adventures, even when they're not mysteries, is some sense of urgency. Some kind of countdown. And again, it has to be written very well, because you have to have a good sense of when your players can get something done, because you don't want to make that deadline too tight. But having that sense of urgency, sort of like an Agatha Christie, you know, locked door mystery, where not only has one person maybe been murdered, but other people might start getting murdered, or, you know, other witnesses might start, you know, disappearing, that kind of thing. Or if a ghost shows up and does something, it might start returning on subsequent nights. Some kind of implied threat that continues, that really pushes the players on and gives them a little sense of urgency. I find that makes an adventure of this type more exciting. So it isn't just a research, you know, kind of, it doesn't just have that feel, because there are some games where people are more used to that. If people are playing Call of Cthulhu, say, they're more used to that researchy, you know, more dry style of play, for lack of a better term. But in D&D, when your players are usually used to fighting fairly often during the session and that sort of thing, if you're going to go this route, I think, A, you have to have players that are down with the concept, and B, you know, kind of know what they're getting into. And B, you have to have, I would say, some sense of urgency, some sense of, you know, excitement in there around talking to people, or things can get a little too dry. And again, I love injecting that into many adventures. You know, I don't think I've ever done a straight up murder mystery, but I've done things that are similar. For Goodman games in the past. I don't have a cover image of it, but Thrones of Punjar, which I did, which was for we're doing fourth edition. It had clues, it had murders going on, you know, there was very similar elements, certainly a sense of urgency. In that case, the players were trying to figure out a kidnapping, basically who had kidnapped somebody, and uncover that, as opposed to a murder, but very similar elements. Because I think once you get used to running these mysteries and incorporating these elements such as urgency into them, you'll find they are applicable, I can't say that word, applicable in your regular play. That you'll find that putting a little urgency or putting some clues in with your regular play, it merges just fine. So there's some lessons to be learned there for the DM. I think every DM should give it a whirl at least once.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. And I think you touched on a great point there. Know your target audience. Make sure your players want a murder mystery, because the last thing you want to do is probably have frustrated players at the table. So, and again, you know, maybe all six of them aren't going to be, you know, engaged in it, but, you know, if you have four of them engaged in it, you know, they're probably going to bring the other two along for the ride and everything. It's easier said than done, but it is nice to try and mix a couple of combats and a couple of different action pieces, set pieces in there if you can. It's not the easiest thing to do, but it is a good change of pace. And you know, you're always trying to keep all the different player character types, you know, engaged and giving them something to do. So sometimes, you know, the murder mystery types are going to be much more focused on role-playing, social interaction, and you know, obviously less on combat and chucking dice. So you want to make sure that you've got a couple things that can kind of keep people still involved, you know, as best that you possibly can. And I think in some ways this module does those things very well. You know, we're going to talk about, I think, where the module falls flat on its face a couple of times, but I think it in general, I think it really hits a lot of things. And right off the bat, I think it's on page three, we get that in this module, we get the chronology of events. And I think that's very, very important. And you're right, to carry that over to a different non-mystery event. You know, I know back in the day in 83, I probably got this module in 84, 83, probably somewhere in there. You know, that chronology of events and the fact that things are going to be happening and evolving around the characters, regardless of what they do, that was a new concept for me back then. I had to wrap my head around that. And I know I probably avoided this module in the beginning because of that. So yeah. Interesting.
It's a good concept. I have always preferred a campaign world where the characters know things are transpiring, where, you know, they have a sense that NPCs are not standing idly in rooms until they show up, that there's a sense of NPCs are going about their business and things are happening. And you're right, certainly with D&D in the beginning. I think later on, when some of the more high-powered campaign worlds came on the scene, like Forgotten Realms, for instance, yeah. Yep. There was a sense, all right, you know, we're not the biggest fish in the pond, you know, that Elminster is doing his thing and these people are doing stuff. But that didn't come along for a while. Certainly wasn't the feel in the 80s, you know, when you were just used to walking your characters down the corridor and the biggest threat was what is behind this door. You know, there wasn't as much a sense of politics or big city adventuring and some of these other kind of things that came along later and were really developed better in later products. But you're right. I think I love that sense of, you know, being a part of an evolving, changing, active world is super important.
Yeah.
And again, that can be very NPC driven. So you got to have your players. And I always think every table always has a mix of players. I always seem to find, you know, there's that role player, ROLL, and then you've got the role player there as well. You know, there's always that one player that likes more the interaction with the NPCs and the other person who just wants to chuck the dice and make it happen. So like you said, know your audience, you know.
Yeah, no, very much so. I saw this just pop up into the chat about comparing L2 to B6, the Veiled Society, which is another great one. And you know what? I don't believe that one was on our radar of modules to review, but I, you know, I think I've run that one more than L2, I think, in the past. I right now, I'm just trying to rack in my brain, trying to think about that one a little bit, but I think B6 was probably pulled off a little bit better. I think if I'd have to, that'd be a really good, you know, we got to put that down on the list of ones to dive into. And if so, we need to circle back around to this one and kind of do a little bit of a comparison back and forth, because I think it's a great point. It's a module that, again, not too many, I think it flies very much under the radar, with a lot of groups. Once you started getting past, you know, B3, B4, there was definitely some, you know, some clunkers in there after that. And I'm not sure everybody appreciates some of the ones. B7 was pretty amazing, actually, if I recall. So that's a good point. So so I think another thing that I think that we really need to touch on is so these types of modules are there is a setting, and it is more of a keyed setting, not necessarily a rooms of a dungeon setting. It's more event driven, I think, really, than anything else. And that can be tricky. That can be tricky to write an event. and to sprinkle events in, because I think part of that is there's a learning curve where the game master needs to know, when am I ready to trigger this event, you know,
Oh,
or
yeah.
did they do X, Y, and Z, and now that we can, you know, spring the to do this or whatever. So I think that's kind of an interesting you know, a kind of a sidebar of that. So I don't know what you think about the event sense.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think events are almost essential. I know, again, when I wrote my Thrones of Punjar, I had events in there, and I even came up with a sort of notoriety system in that if characters would participate in certain events to a certain amount, they would start getting on people's radar. And to me, that's something, because frankly, the reason I came up with that system was in these event-driven scenarios, how much the characters pop up on people's radar or get involved can be important. You know, if characters are in the dungeon and they just go hacking and slashing through the dungeon, there really aren't any repercussions. But if characters are in town or a city or usually one of the places where a murder mystery will take place, usually a more civilized place, they can't just go wantonly killing every suspect. You know, there's certain, and if they start talking to the wrong people, and you know, things can happen. And there's a lot more for the DM to be mindful of, to me, that, you know, even back what I would call background events, you know, not just the scripted events or things that happen to the characters, but if more things along the lines of if the players do A, the NPCs, particularly the bad guys, might do B, that sort of thing. And it gives an extra level of complexity for what the DM's got to keep track of. So it can be harder to run. And truth in advertising, I never ran L2. I certainly read it. I ran L1, but I never ran L2 for whatever reason. I don't know if the murder mystery thing wasn't my taste at the time when I first originally bought it. As you said, I probably got it around 1984 or 1985. I think in later years, I came more to embrace the mystery thing in a bigger way than when I was younger. You know, I think when I was younger, I was more about the monsters and things a little more action-packed.
No, I think I was as well. I think when I first bought it, you know, back then, you know, anytime a new module was available, you didn't even, I
Oh,
mean, they
yeah.
were sealed. You couldn't actually flip through them, but in my opinion, you didn't, you know, I mean, you just bought it. I mean, you just grabbed it off the shelf and threw your money at the person at the front of the you know, the front of the counter, and then you grabbed it. So, and I remember I got it, and then I was very disappointed in it because I looked at it, I was confused. I was like, how am I gonna, I'm like, I can't do this. And I'm like, there's no orcs, there's no goblins. And I'm like, this is weird. And I didn't think my players were gonna like it either. I think I, you know, I really think at that time they would have really been bored about it. I probably didn't run it. I ran it once. I probably ran it late 80s, maybe 87, 88, something like that. And I think our group, I don't know if we really were ready for it then too. And I remember it didn't go particularly well, probably because I didn't run it very well. It was kind of before my RPGA days. And I remember getting into, once I got into the RPGA more, there were several events that were much more role play, much more murder mystery, much more you could play for 4 hours and never pick up a single die kind of thing, where that wasn't, you know, that kind of took a while to get used to all that, I think.
Sure.
So,
And that's a really good observation that I even forget myself, is that when we originally bought these, that's just it. They were in shrink wrap. There was no internet, so you couldn't look up the things to read about. I mean,
You didn't
honestly,
know what was coming out.
no.
You didn't know.
You had the artwork and the little cover blurb maybe on the bottom of the co front cover or on the back cover, and that was it. But you had that like three sentences to go by, you know. And sometimes they didn't come out that often. I tended to buy just whatever module came out. I was on it. So, like you said, until you got it home and cracked it, it was like the great big mystery. You know, you wanted to see the maps. I wanted to see if there were new monsters. You know, you wanted to say, hey, all right. Like it was that. It was a good time actually for me, like a good memory of opening new modules and seeing. But certainly some modules, you know, were not as exciting when I opened them up and actually saw what was in there.
This was definitely one of them, I think. This one definitely took a little bit, looked at, took a little bit more maturity on the side of the game master. And you know, especially, I mean, yeah, I was 13, 14 years old. I wasn't ready for a murder mystery at that point. I wasn't reading Agatha Christie. I wasn't reading, you know, other classic murder mysteries and that. So this is, I was just not ready for this one, and it just took me a time to get back to that appreciation. I have a question for you. So what do you think about red herrings? Do you think they're absolutely necessary, or do you think they're a crutch, or do you think, you know, they should be avoided? Like, what is your general position on the red herring in a murder mystery?
All right. Generally, I like using red herrings. It's something I'll even employ a blatant red herring and a secondary red herring. I've done that. And I think everybody knows what we're saying when we said when we say red herring, but it's an expression.
Red fish.
Yeah. I mean, it's basically, it comes from fox hunting, as I understand, from the 1600s. It's basically a way to lengthen the chase was to throw off the scent of the dogs. And there was a British gentleman's magazine that offered ways to do this. And one way, I hate to say it, was to drag a dead cat along the path. And another way was to drag a quote unquote red herring across the path, because red herring is a cured, smoked, salted fish, and it's really strong in scent. And the idea was, if you drug this fish across the path of the fox, it would mess up the hound's sense of smell and lengthen the, thereby throwing them off the scent. And then that's, as I understand it, that's where the expression comes from, of red herring, for whatever it's worth. Little tidbit of useless information. So, but yeah, I like red herrings. I like to have fun with them and kind of, give the players a few different directions to go. I personally use them.
And Milbort made a comment that, you know, back in the day, the modules, cracking them open is much like Kickstarters today. You have to take your chances. I'll agree with that to an extent, except with Kickstarters these days, though, you know, there's a lot of how to play videos for board games, and there's a lot of review ones, and there's a lot of, I would say, if you don't understand what you're getting into with your Kickstarter, you might not want to back that Kickstarter, because, you know, the product should be mostly done if you've got confidence in them. Now, I mean, I've gambled and I've risked, you know, my hard-earned dollar on some Kickstarters in the day that, you know, that I'm like, well, hopefully this one's going to pay off, and I've gotten burned, and and some have worked out exceptionally well.
Yep.
But yeah, I agree. I think I would say it was even more of a wild west back then, or the dark ages, if you will, because like I said, we didn't even know when these were coming out. I mean, the only way you knew they were coming out was if you got a module and it said it on the back. You know, or you got the hobby dungeon, you know, flyer or something like that, and you knew they were coming. And even in that case, you know, as we all learned with T1-4, you can't believe what you hear. I mean, it was a different time. It was definitely a different time. So, great. Okay, so let's start jumping into this module, because let's get to it. So, first overall impression of the module. What do you got?
All right, overall impression, beyond the obvious, you know, the first TSR murder mystery module. We'll throw that out there. Certainly later in like Dungeon and even Dragon magazine, they certainly did murder mysteries, but to my knowledge, it's the first module that broached that territory. That being said, especially now when I go back and I sort of reread it for this show and kind of, you know, pulled it out and took another hard look at it, I'm amazed at the amount of detail. Now, in the last show, we kind of went into Len Lakofka and, you know, the nature of his writing. And certainly anybody who's familiar with his Tiny Hut column knows the man's not afraid of tables. The man's not afraid of detail. And it shows. But I was sort of staggered of the amount of detail and information that is in this adventure. It does not strike me as a sort of adventure one would write, you know, in a quick spell of writing. There's just so much NPC detail in there of who is here when, and when they go on patrol, and who's in this room at what time, and schedules, and, you know, routines, and how businesses operate, and just so much stuff in here. So I found that very impressive. Now we can talk maybe in a little bit about how usable that is for the DM. But that really impressed me. And you know, as legend has it, Lakofka was paid $11,000 for the series of these Lenore Isles modules, which even today's money would be a princely sum for writing adventures. But back in, you know, in the early 80s or late 70s, whenever he was contracted to do this, was absolutely an outrageous sum. You know, we're talking like 75 cents to a dollar a word. It's crazy. So, you know, one likes to think he earned his money, but I would say the amount of detail in this is wonderful. You know, there's work in this. You can feel it and you can see it when you look through it, that he kind of did his homework. So that I found impressive. What about you? First line impression.
Cover art was not up to standard, I believe. But the interior art was. So we had a reversal of L1, where L1, we had that phenomenal cover art, in my opinion. And then the interior art was not so good. So we kind of had that reversed here. So that was probably my first impression of it. But yeah, I will echo exactly what you say with the detail. And that is where his writing really shines. I mean, his use of tables and charts to convey a large sum of information is amazing and great right at a glance. You know, you can just look at a glance and like, okay, I know what this table is and this is great, instead of it being buried into a couple of paragraphs. So I think phenomenal use of tables and charts. And I remember those old classic Dragon magazine ones as well. So no big shock there, but still, you know, he didn't put garbage in those tables. He put really useful information. And yes, the detail was great. We get a whole nother village. Yeah. We're going to talk about the village a little bit more later. And a whole nother castle. And it's kind of like, did we need another village? And did we need another castle? It's like, but we got it anyway though. And different, you know, it really stood apart. You know, and again, that castle, the detail in the castles. I mean, I remember like, you know, using that castle for a couple of other adventures because it was like everything was there. It was all.
Yeah. Can we get that castle graphic up? I think we have.
Yeah. It. Yeah. If we throw that up there, that'd be great. But that
I love example. And any kind of blueprints like that for, I think, castles, because castles in particular can be very challenging for people to design. You know, it requires a little more knowledge, I think, from the DM. Yeah. And frankly, some DMs just aren't that knowledgeable about real life kind of castle construction and layout and that sort of thing.
I'm not.
it's really hard.
Yeah.
And I love to see examples of that. So anytime there was always a castle, that was always cool. Now, like you said, there was always a sense of, do we really need that second castle when we just had one in L2?
Exactly. Yeah, that was probably it. And then just a couple of other, before we like diving into exactly the adventure, I think Len's use of traps is amazing, and his detail on traps and how to disable traps and just the thought that goes behind. He doesn't say, you know, there's a crossbow. This is a crossbow bolt. You open up the door and you're shot by a crossbow. He gives you the details, like, you know, you can open up the door 3 inches and reach your hand in and you can disable it, so that's how the occupant of the room would get around that trap. And, you know, that kind of thought, that kind of, you know, I kind of consider that dungeon ecology kind of the, you know, well, how can you have a trap on a door that somebody's going to be using all the time? There's got to be a way to either use a different door or whatever. And I've always thinking about that when I'm designing, you know, is this something that, you know, the regular NPC is going to be able to get around or something. So that's fascinating, just his thought that he put into something as simple as like a crossbow trap. And you know, it was just like, I think other designers would just say, I want a trap here and just then put a trap there and just not even think about it anymore. And I almost think back in that time frame, back in the early 80s, late 70s, I think it was accepted. I think you didn't question how did the five orcs get into the room if there's a trap pit in front or something like that. You know, how did they always go around? You know, like so I think that I thought me saw really start turning the corner in design and really start thinking about dungeon ecology is what I've always liked to kind of call it. Yeah. You know, so I think that's pretty fascinating in my
opinion. No, I agree. I love that level of detail. I'm thinking of a room in the inn where, you know, one of the NPCs has a door that's trapped or, you know, and it opens, but so much you can, you know, he makes a point of saying you can kind of slip through this door if it's open crack, but if you just fling it open, you know, if you fling it open, you're going to spring this trap. And I love that because I think, especially come later editions of the game, we've kind of moved away from that. A lot of DMs, we've gotten comfortable with just saying, well, you roll this to perceive this, or you roll this to defy this trap. And I always kind of, you know, my poor players, I always harass them and usually ask them an extra detail, like rather than just accept a perception check, I also ask them what they're doing. Because if I have something hidden on the ceiling, if they make a perception check and they tell me I'm looking up at the ceiling, that counts more in my game than just making a perception check. Mm-hmm. And so maybe I'm old fashioned that way, but I like that extra detail, you know. Mm-hmm. And it gives a bit of a verisimilitude to the traps, you know, having those extra little details. Like you said, that maybe at the time we didn't even know we needed those. You know, we were used to accepting these crazy things like, you know, 16 orcs in a 5x5 room. Mm-hmm. But once you see these details that Lakofka puts in there, it's wonderful. It really makes everything a lot more believable, you know?
Yeah, there's a lot to love in this module. A lot of really good details. A lot of, you know, you could take the murder mystery part out of it and just use the setting and get more than your money's worth out of just having the village and the NPCs and the castle and the maps. I think you've got enough to kind of run with there, because I do admit nowadays, looking back at it, that the actual murder mystery part of this module, really the plot was interesting, the execution of the murder was interesting, and the, you know, kind of how the big bad did it and everything and how he tries to get away with it, but then it kind of stopped there, and it wasn't, there wasn't, in my opinion, enough tools given to the game master to give the players a really good shot at solving this. And I could see where this one could have fell flat and frustrating because of that kind, you know, circling back to what we said, you know, give double the amount of clues you think you're going to need. I think that a really good top-notch dungeon master could work wonders with this module, filling in a lot of gaps, maybe even filling in gaps on the fly and adjusting in real time. But I think if you didn't have a game master worth your salt, and I think I was in that position back in the 80s, I don't think you'd ended up having a good time with this module. And again, that was not on Len at all, because he gave you most of the tools, but just didn't bring it all the way.
That's a good way to put it, is almost like he didn't bring it home. And it's a shame because there is so much wonderful detail. It's like he's described every aspect of this mountain, but he has not given the game master the, you know, the equipment to climb it, almost. That's the way I feel about it.
Yep.
And especially running toward the climax or where the characters even kind of confront the guilty, this can kind of degenerate into a castle raid.
Yeah. And
it's got to be played very carefully, you know, where the characters could really be in trouble. And I don't know. I could see characters being, or players, I should say, being very confused as to what to do. And it, like you said, the way the crime is described is fascinating.
Yep.
But giving the players all the tools they need to reasonably solve that, and then giving the game master, I would think, some more scripted events or something. And there are some events in here. That's the criminal
part
about it. There are sort of events, and in the very beginning of the book, there's a bunch of things that he even describes as sort of side quests, and he talks about how they can kind of delay the investigation or waste time, you know, because again, this module, which I like, has that sense of urgency to it. But he just, as you would put it, he just doesn't bring it home. And it's a shame, because it's a wonderful setting. Reading through this, I felt like for my current game, I could absolutely use this setting, and would even like to use this setting if the character, you know, if the player characters were just traveling somewhere else and had to go through a small town or, you know, a small population center. I could easily just throw this in there and have a slightly shady town that they sort of pass through. Mm-hmm. And they start wandering around and going to different businesses and things, all the details are there. And I would almost, I think, now use it in that capacity as opposed to running the murder mystery.
I agree. I mean, I had a couple of specific things that I had I mean, so on page 30 at the end, kind of in the concluding the adventure wrap up, after you get the wonderful details of the castle, you don't even get like a final confrontation, or you don't get that lead up. Basically, I'm going to read you a quote here. I wrote this down. It said, the DM should stage an exciting and challenging conclusion to the adventure if the party has been reasonably successful. And that's basically it. It's like, he's like, you know, feel free to put that wherever you want, or, you know, maybe that happens in the inn. Maybe that happens in the castle. Maybe that happens on the road back to Restonford when the bad guy goes off to do his second killing. They even say they could get word back to some of the powerful NPCs in L1 and they could stop, you know, the next killing and, you know, or something like that. So it's like, which is not very heroic, you know? So it was a little bit frustrating. And I agree when you mentioned it, you know, that the party could get into some serious trouble here. You know, the big bad was a dual classed character. And I don't know if you remember the dual class rules, but a 5/6th dual class character, not multi-class character. Right. Is an 11th level character.
Yeah.
And your characters are 2nd to 5th level, and you have a cleric assassin that, you know, with some very powerful magic items, mind you, and the backing of some other powerful NPCs, although they're all appropriately leveled around 5 to 6 level, it could go pretty bad pretty quickly. I mean, an 11th level character is not something 2nd to 3rd to 4th level characters should be going up against. No. In addition to a lot castle.
Of, you know, leaving that final encounter that way kind of puts a lot of heat on the DM's shoulder. I realize that these kind of, the style of adventure can go many different directions, obviously. But that almost seems, again, it's not bringing it home. It's sort of like saying, well, if you're having a really good, you know, really good time reading this book, we'll let you fill in the final chapter. And no, if I buy an adventure, I want to get the final fight.
Yeah.
In there. And you know, it's funny that you mentioned too, like the dual class, because I thought that character is very powerful. And my other thought when I read this is just how many magic users are in this town. You know,
a lot.
It seems like every other shopkeeper is like a retired magic user. I didn't count, but I would love to go back and count just how many, if I had a nickel for every thief or magic user in this town, you know, it's funny, you know.
I almost think he did count. Hang on a second.
All right. That would be really interesting. Did. Oh, is there a grid maybe somewhere where he lists everybody? Because that would be
I kind of felt that there was.
There's quite a few. There's a lot.
There are 25 magic users out of 200 and some people. It says right there, 25. Yeah, there's more.
And I don't mind, you know, the occasional person being a magic user or the occasional.
No, I'm sorry. There's 12. I'm sorry, reading the chart wrong. So yeah, there's 12 magic users and illusions. That's still a lot.
That's a lot for a little town.
there's 166 adults.
Wow.
And 12 of them are magic users. There's some things like that, and a lot of them have magic items. You know, almost all of them have magic items and everything, and that's fine. It's just that, you know, that was probably, you know, some of my bigger disappointments. And the other thing too, so obviously if you guys have not figured out, there's an Assassin's Guild in this town, and one of the other things I think was really missing, I mean, Len does a great job of you know, the Assassin's Guild, not all the members know everybody else. Mm-hmm. But so he's got that in the running text. He says, this person knows this person doesn't know this person, this person knows this person. And there is a table, and it sort of explains a little bit of who knows who, but not exactly.
Yeah.
This book really needed a graphic, a flow chart of which assassin knows which other assassin, and which villager knows them. And I'm a little bit surprised it wasn't included. We got 3 maps of the actual village, like closing in a closest, an overhead shot, another shot. Feel like could use a half page in there somewhere where we could have really used a nice flow chart to kind of to detail the hierarchy of the Assassin's Guild, which I think would have really helped and would have really given that nice blueprint for other aspiring game masters who wanted an Assassin's Guild in their own campaign down the road. So
I wholeheartedly agree. I mean, we can bear down on some of the locations a little more in detail, but going right to the inn, the House of Abraham, there's a lot of details there about
yep.
this assassin knows that this assassin's working for the guild and this assassin doesn't. And then you've got a barkeep who's a spy, you know, for the, yep. the mayor. And even some of the head assassins in the inn don't know that the barkeep is a spy. And it's extreme. Just that one inn, who knows who and who knows who's in the guild and all this kind of thing. It's fascinating detail for the DM, all this background material, but yeah. it's very hard to keep track. And there's so many NPCs and so many names that when reading it later, I read about, you know, somebody at the theater who had, who was liked by somebody else. And I had to go digging to try to find out who the devil this person was who liked, you know, this, yep. this one theater hand. And some sort of master table of NPCs and who knows what would have gone a long way.
I agree. And you know, so let's jump into this kind of a walking tour of Garotten, the village, which doesn't sound like a bad place at all. but yeah, so the first and you mentioned it first, we had the kind of like the wilderness encounters and some of the other events and things that can happen around town, and most of them they were designed to waste time and to distract the PCs, but some of them were combat orientated. Mm-hmm. And I could see players wanting to go hunt an octopus in the lake or go, you know, battle some giant crabs on the beach because they want to fight something, they want to roll initiative. So I mean, I think that kind of played into it. I love those. I kind of wish there was a little bit more. I kind of mm-hmm. wish there was maybe a one day, you know, elk hunt or something like that, or a fox hunt or something right. like that, where you could actually get to know some of the NPCs a little bit differently, and interact with them and maybe even learn something about them. Then we get to the House of Abraham, which is the inn. And you're right, so many details there in that. And at first it was like too many details compared to the other areas, mm-hmm. except for the fact that you got to keep in mind that it's the inn, it's probably where they're going to stay.
Yeah.
And it's probably where they're going to spend most of their time. So, and they might even meet other NPCs at the inn. So it probably made sense to go through a lot of details there and to really give that probably more attention than the other two major sites, because there was three major sites that, you know, they really kind of went into a lot of detail. But yeah, lots of, I love, you know, Len's presentation of a location. It's like, you've got your map, you've got your list of details, you've got your NPC roster, you've got your intrigues at the inn of, you know, what, who knows what, who's suspicious of who, and then you've got the key to the inn, which is great too. And it's like everything there that you need to basically go and run and, you know.
And it's a really interesting presentation, as you say, because it's almost like a three-step presentation, because he sort of gives you the stat blocks and the information of the NPCs. But then separately, he kind of talks about each NPC in turn and what they know, and then use it. And then he goes on to key the rooms. So there's a lot of wonderful information there. And I'll give him bonus points for making the innkeeper psionic, which I think is totally unexpected. And, you know. Even back when psionics was a thing, it really wasn't always a thing. So it was like that always usually threw players for a loop when suddenly you threw psionics into the game.
Yeah.
So I thought that was really fascinating that he threw that little bit in there. And then it goes into good detail about how the person uses his psionic abilities, you know, and it fits with the character in a really interesting way. Yeah. So it's not just a, you know, like a one-off add-on that, oh, let's just make this guy psionic. It really fits with the innkeeper and what he's doing in this sort of dangerous game that the innkeeper is playing about who he knows and who he suspects. Yep.
And all of his suspicions,
Yeah. Again, maybe some of it falls into the category of interesting background material for the DM that may not distill down to the players. I don't know. But I did find it interesting. And on a totally separate note, since you kind of called it out, I love the map structure. When the maps sort of keep zooming in like that, it's literally like a four-stage zoom in. You've got, you know, the far view way outside of Garotten, and then you kind of zoom in, you know, twice to the Garotten area, and then Garotten itself, and then if you kind of if you look at the House of Abraham, then it even focuses in on that, where you go from, you know, zoom one to two, boom, boom, boom. You know, I love that. It's I think the one big map doesn't have a distance key on it, which I guess you could extrapolate from the other ones. I think that was the only thing I noticed, but I love the fact that it keeps zero. I just think that's so cool.
And there was an extra cardboard insert of maps too. Yeah. So you got basically double the maps that you normally would have.
Yeah.
So you had the hard outer one, but then you had another whole one. So you actually had to, so you had a lot of panels there.
Here.
Yeah. To work off of. So again, amazing that you get all that material in this package, and all that stuff is just so useful when trying to run this. Now, and again, at each one of these three major locations, we've got the inn, we've got the church, we'll get to that in a second, and we've got the theater. Again, the clues, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of suspicions, there's a lot of NPC interactions, but not a whole lot of clues tying it all in together. There's basically one little clue at each one, and in my opinion, two out of three of the sites, it's a very weak connection on where that clue is, and wow, the players really need to dig hard if they're gonna get the clue there. I think the one at the theater I thought was very well done, but the other two really weren't. And again, I think that's gonna really come back to the skill level of the game master. So
yeah, I agree. All right, so we've talked about the inn. Why don't we go on to one of the other major locations? Why don't we go on to the church?
Definitely the church. Yeah. Which is by far my favorite part of the module, I think.
It's fun, isn't it? Isn't that a fun location?
It is. Well, I mean, you know, it's an aquatic deity right off the bat. So with Barracuda for three Barracuda for a symbol. So you know I was going to like that part. So
and to address the comments, L2 is considered a loose sequel to L1. Honestly, there isn't a direct connection, but you have two connected locations and NPCs interacting across the two locations. So I think it's considered a sequel in that way. But anyway, I'm sorry. Yeah, please continue.
So great. Again, now less details on the church site, like the map actually wasn't keyed. But again, you're probably not going to spend that much time at the church, and you're probably not going to be wandering around the church like you would an inn. So probably not needed. But again, you get the same detail with the NPCs. And I love the way Len presents the NPCs. You know, he gives you the physical description, the age, you know, something about what they're wearing, and then some sort of personality quirk, and then the stats. And it's like you have in like three or four sentences, you kind of have everything that you need to pull off an NPC. And the head of the church, Harper, is great. I mean, he is
love it.
Ninth level cleric. And right off the bat, ninth level cleric, you're like, whoa, he's got some high level spells. He could like wreck this whole plot and everything. So what does Len do? What he does the best, like he did all throughout L1 when he gives you a boon, but then he gives you like a weakness or some kind of something to hold you back on it. He makes him senile and a doddering old fool. Mm-hmm. And he randomly, he's so not with it. He randomly determines his high level spells every day. He doesn't even like, you know, actually memorize the spells he would need. And then he
makes a point to cast them.
He makes sure he casts them all day. So he'll just randomly, he's just like sitting there. We can call up that one graphic where there's the picture of the guys at the table and the
flame strike
going off in the back.
Flame strike graphic.
Yeah. He'll just like rip off his
flame strike
in the middle of a conversation.
That's such a great picture. It's so evocative of that.
And it's great because, you know, it makes sense. You know that Len thought through, well, I want a high level cleric here, but how can I balance that off? Otherwise the high level cleric could speak with dead or cast commune or whatever and ruin everything. You know, how can I balance that? And that's how he does it. And it's like a very memorable.
It's very skillfully done because the combination of his sort of senility or whatever, plus the fact that you have to sort of get through the underlings to get to him. And there's a point made that one of the underpriests basically does not, he's kind of giving you excuses and saying, well, you know, if you want to talk to him, he's in prayer. He's this, he's that. He's too busy. So they don't make it an easy matter for characters to just go running to the high cleric for aid. So I think that's really fun. But and even if he, there's a note that if he performs services, he spins wheels on the wall.
Yeah, I want to talk about that to determine the random cost. Now this is amazing. This is amazing that this is in the module here. That like for a first or second level spell, you roll percentile dice, and that's how much he'll charge you. If it's a third or a fourth level spell, it could be 0 to 999. You roll like 3 percentile dice, I guess, 3 die 10. And if it's a fourth or fifth level spell, it could be up to 9,990. And that's it. He sets the prices for the day based on the wheel spins, and that's it. Which it's odd. That should have been in the House of Big Gamble in L1. I almost feel like Len forgot that was a thing back then where you had the gambling church. Like that would have been perfect. And I actually thought that the House of Big Gamble had the wheels. And I remember when I reread L1, I was like, damn, I remember this wheel thing with, and I'm like, where did that go? And I'm like, did I just make that all up in my head? And no, it was in this module, but it was like slightly misplaced, but
still, no, you're right.
Excellent little gimmick.
I know some of my Greyhawk gods much better than others, and I'll admit, to lacking on this particular series of gods that are presented in the, I think he features 3 Greyhawk gods in this
project. I think he
but I think this was even a lawful god, wasn't it?
I believe so, yeah.
So it you know, you have this very chaotic behavior.
But again, his thought process there was like, well, it's a deity of the sea, so it doesn't really care about what's going on at land. And I'm like, wow. So absolutely amazing. We did have a question here. G Blaster wants to know if the level of village detail is comparable to T1. I'll actually say it's better. I'll be honest with you. There's 54 keyed locations. They don't all have full descriptions, but they are all included on this massive chart that gives a summary of everything. All the NPCs that are detailed are named, which is great. And again, there's these summarizing charts which T1 didn't have. There's these percentages of who's where, when. I'd actually say you could tell that T1 was the first village. And then the villages that came after it, they built on it. They built on that template, like N1 did that, and now this module is doing that too. So,
yeah, I think it could be argued that in some ways, Garotten feels more like a living, breathing place.
Yeah,
Hamlet, Gygax, sort of, and Mensur. They kind of very well. Really, Hamlet was Gygax. Very dryly present the locations, very, and it was very old school, very, he lives here, this is their treasure, that's it. Where in this, as you say, there's almost a hyper level of detail when it comes to who's on, who's on duty at this time, and who's going from this place to that place, and who's on the guard roster, and who's the guard captain during this shift, and all this kind of stuff that is not. Now, Hamlet's got some of that where when you start talking about the interactions between the agents in Hamlet, the power players, I guess, if you want to call them, and the agents of evil, then Gygax goes into that detail. But for most of the mundane people, I find it very dry. It gives you the bare bones where I think there's a better level of detail.
Yeah. And like I said, most of the ones in Hamlet weren't even named. So this one at least had a lot of the really good names and everything. So we love the chat coming in. Love to see that.
Good.
So anyway, we're running out of show rapidly here. We still got some stuff to talk about. So the third big, the third of 4 really detailed areas to talk about is the Theater of the Mystic Celebration. Mm-hmm. And this was kind of cool. Again, less detailed map because you don't have advocacy to just walk around this place. It's a thriving business, so it's like you can't just walk backstage probably without causing an issue. So, but again, we have the detailed NPCs, and we have a little nice couple paragraph description of the theater and how it works and how when the shows are and interesting that there's the dressing rooms are well stocked and by this point they might realize that whoever has been doing these murders are disguising themselves as different people, so that might really put them on the case there. I think a game master could really make that argument and really could make that case a little bit there. And again, I mentioned earlier, I thought the clue of the three clues that you have to investigate this, I think it was strongest in the theater. And we're specifically not kind of, we don't really want to spill all the beans on this adventure just in case you guys were to play it. But this is the one where I think the clue kind of worked. And it was a really nice backstory. It's the one that you alluded to earlier, the stagehand and the other love interest, and how you could see that the assassins manipulated an innocent person to kind of do the dirty work and everything. And you could see how that stagehand could kind of get caught in the middle, and maybe bad things probably happened to it. So to that person. So I thought this was kind of a pretty compelling location because of that. But obviously did not have the detail of the other locations. Didn't have that memorable encounter like the cleric or the NPC.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think the mystery is solid here. I love the location. The idea of presenting a theater and giving the DM some information on it, I think is wonderful. I like the main character of, I'm going by memory, Balmoro, I want to say.
Yeah, Balmoro. I always thought it was Barth Balmoro. Yeah.
Well, and he has a blink dog, I think, as a pet. I think he's the blink dog as a pet, which of course is never hurts anything. But yeah, I like, because he's presented as a strong NPC, but and he's suspicious. And you can tell, like, this is a person who could be recruited as an ally potentially certainly for the players. But very, very nicely presented. So a good location. And I think a theater is one of those businesses that is not always presented in a lot of adventure things. So that's fun too, just by its being a little bit unusual.
Yeah, agreed.
So why don't we delve into the castle, the big last area.
And again, there's several pages of this module are taken up by the castle. Again, amazing maps. We talked about it a little. I kind of questioned, like, did we need another castle? We got this big, huge castle in L1, and he even says, sit tight, people. Like, I know it seems like weird that you're getting this castle in L1, but you're going to definitely want it in L2. Mm-hmm. And then we get to L2, and it's like, well, here's another castle. And now, again, love the castle, love the details, love the maps, but did we really need it? I mean, was it really, I just felt like maybe this all could have been set in Restonford, saved on some of the details, and we could have put more into the plot. It's just interesting, very interesting thought process there.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think it's well done. I think it's interesting. A lot of interesting traps, as you mentioned earlier. A lot of poison use. So certainly the characters have to be on their toes. It seemed like, different statues that would do things and poison. This was involved a lot. So, it could be potentially dangerous for the characters. But yeah, good, solid, cool location. Like you said, whether we need to or not. But I think there's... potential there for future adventures. And before I forget, my memory was jogged that this had appeared in Dungeon Magazine, and I did my digging and went back and found that in Dungeon 71, there was actually sort of a return to Restonford where they present sort of subsequent adventures after post Assassin's Knot, which I thought was really interesting. And they kind of tell you kind of what's happened in Restonford after this murder, investigation and the murder's taken place, what happens and how some of the NPCs are acting. So if people are a fan of this module, there's something, there's an avenue of further adventures.
Did Len write that?
Or was that somebody else? No, he did not.
Oh, okay.
Len did go on to write three more modules. I mean, I think people know kind of the saga of L3. And then I believe kind of for the Dragonfoot community, Len presented L4 and L4 for free. I think he put them up. So we kind of got five works from Len, but no, the adventure in Dungeon was written by somebody else. And I don't know the author off the top of my head.
Gotcha.
But I did find it was interesting. And there's actually a cool elevated map of Restonford in Dungeon, and they made some changes to it. They took out some sort of less necessary buildings, and they added like a sort of seawall type of thing that I noticed. So they made a few little tweaks to it, which I kind of like stuff like that. I think it's interesting because, again, it gives it a sense of an evolving place. I like callbacks like that. So
No, I agree. You know, what I loved about the castle was, again, the tables and the charts that summarized the guard duties, the servants, the duty roster and everything. Amazing detail that went into who was where and everything. I thought that was a really nice a touch that we probably didn't necessarily need, but it definitely, again, breathes more life into it. And definitely at each of those locations, you always got the, here's the person that lives in this room, here's the percentage chance that they're going to occur here during the day, during the night, what they're going to be doing. Phenomenal detail. And like I said, really makes it a living, breathing environment, which we love. I mean, that's a true hallmark of an excellent, excellent adventure.
I agree.
That's about what we got for this module. So we touched on a bunch of different things. We have another show coming up in a couple of weeks. Rick, do you want to tell them about that? Because it's pretty exciting. Sure.
Yeah, I hope you will join us, folks. Our next show is on August 22nd at 8 p.m. again. And we are going to do our final excursion, if you will, into the Temple of Elemental Evil. This time we're going to drill down into the elemental nodes, which was really interesting because that's an area where Chris and I really did some expansion work, and indeed probably the most expansion in the new original Adventures Reincarnated version of the Temple of Elemental Evil. That was the area that got the most love and expansion and new material from us. And we really want to talk about that in detail as a last show on the Temple of Elemental Evil before the book itself comes out. So we hope you will join us again on August 22nd. If you're enjoying our show, by all means, give us a follow. If you're watching us later on YouTube, give us a like, or better yet, ring the little bell and give us a subscribe, and keep the comments coming. We love them.
Yeah. No, we had a great comment night tonight. There was quite a bit. We were having trouble keeping track of it all and everything. as most folks know, I know everybody's eagerly awaiting Temple of Elemental Evil to come. So we did mention way back in March that it was going to get here in August, and today is August 1st. So all I'm going to say about that is keep an eye on the website. You're probably going to hear some announcements coming very soon. Hopefully during that show on the 22nd of August, hopefully we're going to have some really, really awesome news to share with everybody as we dive into those nodes. And again, just so you folks are aware, the nodes were not fully designed, as Rick said, and we did fully design them. So we're going to show off some maps. We're going to show off some of the encounters. We're going to discuss some of our favorite encounters. We're going to really talk a lot about this, because this was really the part of the conversion where we got to have a lot of fun and do some cool things and really kind of, but with basically using the source material. So it was very, very exciting to be able to kind of do the treatment of nodes and kind of do the nodes right and everything and prepare them so that a game master could just pick them up and do it. And actually, I don't know if you any folks remember in the chat, but we actually ran several of the nodes at some of the conventions, the virtual convention we're doing. They're perfect. They're not perfect. You can't get through an entire node in 2 or 3 hours, but it's nice where you can say, hey, I'm just going to run the fire node. Come on, come join us. And we're just going to adventure in the fire node for a little bit. So it's kind of it makes it a nice little one shot. Also, I could see you could use all four of those nodes as one shot. So, all right. So we're going to wrap up. So that was Sunday, August 22nd, 8 p.m. Please join us for that show. And now our pearls of wisdom. And it looks like I'm going to go first. So my pearl of wisdom is really, I think Len kind of flies under the radar as one of the better game designers out there. I think a lot of aspiring game masters and even designers could learn a lot by seeing some of the tricks of the trade that he does, his use of tables, his use of charts, his detail on NPCs, and obviously understanding how medieval garrisons and castles work doesn't hurt either. But I think that these modules are certainly worth it. I think these modules are probably some of the more useful ones that you could purchase now and use in a fifth edition game or even a DCC game. Obviously you got to do some work with the stats, but for the most part though, the maps are there, the NPCs are there, the personalities are there. everything is there, a nice skeleton that you can just take and start doing whatever you want with, really with probably, I won't say minimum work, but with not a whole lot of work. So that would be my pearl of wisdom for this week.
Good one. Mine sort of dovetails with yours as usual. I would say, you know, my pearl of wisdom is very similar in that I would encourage people. I always encourage DMs to try new things, try, you know, throw the different, something different at their players every so often to shake up the apple tree. And in this case, I think occasionally the less monster type adventure, you know, where you're more interacting with NPCs, a little more human centric, occasionally going that route is interesting. And I was going to say just kind of what you said in that this module in particular provides a wonderful blueprint of a living, breathing castle and a few good businesses and something that a DM can really use as a template and make places breathe. You know, we talked earlier about having events and people and a living sort of environment that's moving and flowing around the characters, and that doesn't feel like, you know, when the characters open a door, this happens as much as the place is living and breathing and going on. And that's what I would encourage the DMs to do is whether or not murder mysteries are your thing, there are some excellent adventures like this that have wonderful resources that you can use in your game today. And you can easily take some of the businesses in here and run a more human-centric adventure as a change of pace. And I think your players could really enjoy that. And there's lots to be taken from this module. So look for these little nuggets of gold in these old books, you know, because they're there. Age does not mean they're not useful. They are.
Yeah, otherwise I don't think we'd be talking about them.
Exactly. That's right. So, there's a reason they hold up, right?
Yeah, I'd like to think that, you know, I'd like to think that there's something there if we're talking about them 40 years later.
Yeah.
So great. So so thank you everybody for tuning in on a Sunday night. We had a blast like we always do. It got us through another Sunday night, and it got us through another not being at Gen Con. So you know, hopefully we got better times coming ahead, hopefully. Like to give a shout out to Elena for doing a great job producing our show once again. Couldn't do it without her. So with that, we are going to sign off, and we will see you guys in 3 weeks. Everybody be well.
Good night, folks. Be well.